Welcome. Let's talk about the last part of module 1. And the last part is part 7, which is the doctrine of equitable recoupment. This subject is possible in the bar because it was given once in 2009. So what is the doctrine of equitable recoupment? Jurisprudence versus collector teaches us that if there's a claim for refund as a result of excessive taxes collected, erroneously collected taxes, or mistakenly paid taxes, and the period for refund has prescribed, then the prescribed claim could be used as an offset or could be recouped against future tax liabilities. This particular concept is not applicable in the Philippines because taxpayers, knowing that they could use as an offset their prescribed claims, become lazy in paying their taxes. And by the same token, tax collectors also, knowing that the taxpayers have a prescribed claim, which they could offset against tax liabilities, would become lazy in making assessments and collecting taxes. So let's have a look at the bar exam asked in the past, which is nothing more than an objective type. What is the doctrine of equitable recoupment? Is it applicable in our jurisdiction? Now, we go back to the same concept of the music all along, 5 and 10%. If the subject weight has a weight of 5% or less, then your answer is going to be short. On the other hand, if the question weight is more than 5%, then expand your answer. As you will see here, the answer is longer than the first one. Prohibition of compensation and set-off is more probable than the first one. Why? Because it was asked twice in the decade of the 2000s, once in 2001 and another in 2005. Why is there a prohibition on compensation and set-off? There is a prohibition because of the lifeblood doctrine. If we allow compensation and set-off, then the tax revenues would diminish and consequently, the existence of the state will be put to danger. Furthermore, taxes are not contractual obligations but duty enforced by law. And finally, the government taxpayers are not mutually debtors and creditors of each other. But do you understand when you say that the government and taxpayers are not mutually debtors and creditors of each other? What it means here is that in one instance, the taxpayer is the creditor and the government is the debtor. And then in the matter of collecting taxes, the roles are reversed. The government is not the creditor and the taxpayer is the debtor. There are instances when there could be compensation and set-off in the case of local taxes, and that's the only time when the concept of mutuality of being debtors and creditors come into play. Let us have a look at a model for analysis of questions involving compensation and set-off. First, let's look at the tax. Is the tax a national or a local tax? If the tax is a national tax, then generally there should be no compensation set up, as we said, because of the lifeblood doctrine, the duty to pay taxes arises from law, and furthermore, you do not apply the concept of mutuality of debtor-creditor relationship. But having said that, is there any instance when there could be compensation set up between a national tax and a debt? Yes, in the case of solution debity. In the instance where there was a mistaken payment made by the taxpayer, the government should return under the concept of no unjust enrichment. The government is not immune from that concept. Supposing that the tax is local. If the tax is local, then also, General rule, no compensation setup for the same reason that we talked about a while ago. However, if the elements of legal compensation sets in, then there could be now an offset between a tax and a debt. Question. Why is it that there are certain instances when offset or setup is allowed between a tax and a debt for local taxes but not in national taxes? Let's go back and recall the concept of the lifeblood doctrine. Under the lifeblood doctrine, taxes have to be collected if the continued existence of the state is to be assured. But if you don't pay your taxes, remember, to the local government, the state still exists. But if the state does not exist as a result of the non-payment of national taxes, then the local governments also cease to exist. That's the reason why you have the differential treatment between national taxes and local taxes. So remember again the level of analysis. Is it a national tax? Is it a local tax? If it's a national tax, no general rule, no compensation set up. Because of the lifeblood doctrine, the duty is to pay taxes. The parties that mutually designate letters of each other. Exception, solution, deputy. Local taxes, same thing, no compensation set off. But you don't talk about the lifeblood doctrine here anymore. You talk about the other reasons. And then you have legal compensation coming in. So, this is the concept when there could be compensation and setup. Let me repeat. Where both claims already become overdue and demandable, as well as fully liquidated, compensation takes place by operation of law under Article 1200 in relation to Articles 1279 and 1290 all of the Civil Code, as in accordance with the case of Domingo versus Garlitos. Compensation takes place by operation of law, where the part government and taxpayer are in their own right, reciprocally or mutually debtors and creditors of each other, and that the debts are both due and demandable. This is in consequence of the provisions of the Civil Code as interpreted in the case of Domingo versus Garlitos. In case of a tax overpayment, the payer's obligation to refund or offset arises from the moment the tax was paid. And the reason, of course, is solution debity. The government should not also unduly enrich itself at the expense of the taxpayer, because then taxpayers will become discouraged in paying their taxes. Let's have a look at an example here involving the case of Sampaguita Pictures. Well, judgment should be rendered in favor of the Republic for unpaid taxes. Judgment owed at the same time should issue for Sampaguita Pictures, commanding payment to the latter by the Republic of the value of the back pay certificates which the Republic received. That's the case of Republic versus Rica. Let's go back and review legal compensation. These are the elements of legal compensation, which we said is applicable only to local government taxes and not to national taxes. That each of the obligors may principally and at the same time be at the same time a principal creditor of the other, that both debts consist in a sum of money, or if the things are due or consumable, they be of the same kind and also of the same quality. The two debts are due, they be liquid and demandable, that over neither of them be any retention or controversy, commenced by third persons and communicated in due time to the debtor. These are the exact provisions of Article 1279. Let us look at the type of bar questions asked in the past in this particular area. First, we have question number one, which is a fact-centered problem and is very, very long. So therefore, in this case, as always, you go to the bottom of the question in order to find out what the examiner wants. So, what does the examiner want? The examiner wants you to discuss the merits of the appeal. But you don't understand what is the issue involved here. It merely says merits of the appeal. So in this particular case, you go back one sentence. She claims that the tax delinquencies have been extinguished by legal compensation. So in this particular regard, the thing you're going to do is try to determine how you're going to analyze the problem, because it involves one of legal compensation. So let's go back and recall the simple analytical framework I've taught you a while ago, using again the model. First, understand what is the subject of the tax being the subject of compensation, etc. Is it a national tax or is it a local tax? If it is a national tax, you have the general rule that there should be no compensation set off, with the exception of solution indemnity. If it is a local tax, general also, no compensation set off unless the elements of legal compensation kicks in. What are the elements of legal compensation and are they present in the problem? The elements of legal compensation are that, number one, the parties are mutually debtors and creditors of each other. And in the second instance, both of the debts are due and demandable. And do not forget, the concept of legal compensation finds application only to local taxes and not to national taxes. So with that out of the way, let's now have a look at the factual setting again, trying to find out whether there is a factual equivalent of the legal elements of legal compensation. Ms. Ena Dinoso is the registered owner of a residential lot with a two-story house situated in Naga City. Notice, the longer the problem is, the more items there are that has nothing to do with the solution of the problem. For example, does it matter that this is a two-story house? Does it matter that this residential lot? It doesn't matter. The lot with an area of 328 square meters is described and covered by TCD number 4739 of the Registry of Deeds of Naga City. Notice, this has nothing to do with legal compensation. On September 12, 2018, a 115 square meter portion of Edna's property was expropriated by the Republic of the Philippines for the sum of 6,700 pesos, representing the assessed value of the aforesaid portion. This amount was deposited by the government in Edna's account. So, see now. So, in this instance, Edna is the creditor. The national government is the debtor. So, notice, you now have the relationship between the parties insofar as expropriation is concerned. For almost 10 years, Edna failed to pay her real estate taxes on the same property. Thus, on November 5, 2018, her property was sold at public auction by the city treasurer of the city to satisfy real estate tax delinquencies to 5,800. The highest bidder for the property was Angel Chua. Now, the other relationship between the parties. There is now due real property taxes. And here in real property taxes, Edna is the debtor and the local government of Naga City is the creditor. So let's go back. You've found out by now that there is no mutuality of debtor-creditor relationship and that the tax involved here is a local tax. Why is there no mutuality? In the first instance, in the expropriation case, the debtor is the national government. In the second case, in the real property tax, the creditor is the local government. So therefore, just by looking at that, you know now that legal compensation is not a valid ground for Edna to appeal. So you now have a conclusion, and the only thing to do is try to find out if there are any other statements in the facts that don't change your hypothesis. Hypothesis is your preliminary answer. Edna was not present at the public auction, although she later admitted having received the notice of hearing for the petition for entry of a new certificate of title by Angel Chua. It doesn't matter. This has nothing to do. So don't be confused. You might think that there are due process considerations involved here. That is not what the examiner is testing. That has no relation to the question. So, on March 15, 2019, Edna filed a complaint to annul the auction sale, which was denied by the RTC judge of Naga City. In fact, the RTC judge ordered that a new title be issued to Angel Chua. No relation to the problem. because the issue is legal compensation. On appeal, the Court of Appeals affirmed the RTC decision in toto. EDA then elevated the case to the Supreme Court, citing several grave errors of law, among which that the tax delinquencies involving 5,800 for non-payment of real estate taxes were offset by the sum of 6,700 which the government of the Philippines owed her. She claims that the tax delinquencies have been extinguished by legal compensation, discussed the merits of the bill. So you would notice now that the issue is legal compensation. In the analysis of the problems, you would have noticed that there may have been issues involving due process, because Edna did not participate, although she claims she had been notified of the public auction. But that is beside the point. That is not an issue you should discuss. You'd focus on the main issue, which is legal compensation. So as usual, we'll have to look at the percentage points, whether it's 5% or less or more than 5%. So how are you going to answer if the weight is 5% or less? You have this, you conclude, and then you reason out why so. So let's just have a look at this one by one, because I would like to remember how we're going to analyze and how we're going to craft your answer. Start with the conclusion, if merited. Edna's appeal is without merit. And now you follow up with why. Because you must explain your reasons why you arrive at the conclusion. And this is how you're going to reason out. Remember, the reasoning process is, again, interweaving between the elements of the law and the elements of the fact. Edna and Naga City are not mutually creditors and debtors of each other under the civil code. Why? Because taxes are not in the nature of a contract between the government and the taxpayer. Number two, furthermore, the tax was due to the city government while the expropriation was effected by the national government. Notice that the answer is short. But supposing the weight is more than 5 points. If the weight is more than 5 points, then you have no choice but to expand your answer. And you will expand your answer if you could recall the exact provisions of law. If not, you embellish by adding some words. In short, you're going to have a multiplication of words in the instance where it's more than 5%. So Edna's appeal is without merit because number one, the government and taxpayer are not mutually creditors and debtors of each other under Article 1278 of the Civil Code. Why? Because a claim for taxes is not such a debt, demand, contract, judgment as is allowed for set off. Number two, the reason on which the general rule is based is that taxes are not in the nature of contracts between the government and the taxpayer, but grows out of duty to and are the positive acts of the government to the making and purpose of which the personal consent of the individual taxpayer is not required. The collection of the tax cannot await the results of the lawsuit against the government. Number three, recoupment is not proper as taxes do not arise out of the contract or transaction should upon. Number four, the tax was due to the city government while the expropriation was affected by the national government. There could be no legal compensation within the context of Domingo versus Galitos because the parties are not mutually debtors and creditors of each other. Lastly, Edna had knowledge of the 6,700 deposited in her favor. She could have withdrawn the same and paid her tax accountability of 1,800, thus aborting the auction sale. This was the holding in the case of Francia versus Intermediate Appellate Court. So remember again, how are we going to expand? Last word on this one. It is not imperative for you to cite the cases, although if you could remember the cases, then well and good. But be sure that it is the proper case that's being cited. In short, the doctrinal rulings in the case are on force with the problem shown in the bar examinations. We have another question that may be given on the subject, and this one is basically an objective type of question, which is a theoretical discussion type. In an assessment for a local tax by the subject of set-off or compensation against a final judgment for a sum of money obtained by the taxpayer against the local government that made the assessment. Again, 5% and more than 5% rule is going to be applied in the analysis of this problem. So this time, I'll not discuss this very well. I'll just run through it. Less than 5, 2-sentence answer is already perfect. More than 5%, then expand your answer. What about compromise? The Civil Code defines that a compromise is a subject whereby the parties to mutual agreement make reciprocal concessions in order to avoid a litigation or put an end to one that's already been commenced. So remember, mutual agreement. So there must be agreement between the parties. And they make reciprocal concessions. They give each other concessions to avoid the litigation or if one has already been commenced, to put an end to it. I shall not discuss for you the questions involving compromise. Why? Because we'll talk about it when we discuss Module 5, Tax Remedies under the National Internal Revenue Code. So until then, we'll not discuss compromise. What about tax amnesty? Is tax amnesty probable? Yes. It has been given twice in 2001 and 2011. Furthermore, there was recently enacted a law on tax amnesty. That's why I think the area is something that is rather dangerous for you, and you should take into consideration this fact that it was given twice already in the decade of the 2000s. But what is tax amnesty? A tax amnesty refers to the articulation of the absolute waiver by a sovereign of his right to collect taxes and the power to impose penalties on persons or entities guilty of violating a law. Do not confuse tax amnesty with political amnesty. Why? In the case of a tax amnesty, it is Congress under its power to tax that could grant tax amnesties. And since tax amnesty is akin to an exception, then majority vote of all the members of Congress could grant tax amnesty. However, in the case of political amnesty, it is the president that grants political amnesty subject to approval of Congress. And there is no provision that the vote to grant political amnesty must be by majority vote of the members of Congress. So, what is the purpose of tax amnesty? There are two purposes of tax amnesty. The first is to grant a general reprieve to tax evaders who wish to come clean by giving them an opportunity to straighten out their records. Also, it gives the government a chance to collect and collect taxes from tax evaders without spending so much and going through the tedious process known as the judicial process. What are general conditions for tax amnesty? But remember, I said general conditions because each tax amnesty law has a specific provisions providing for certain conditions that are unique only for that particular tax amnesty that was granted. So this is general, and this general must be reflected in a law, in the tax amnesty law, before it could be allowed. To avail of tax amnesty granted by the government and to be immune from suit on its delinquencies, the taxpayer must have voluntarily disclosed his previously untaxed income and must have paid the corresponding tax on such previously untaxed income. This was the holding in the case of Banyas Jr. What is the recent tax amnesty law? The recent tax amnesty law is Republic Act number 11-13, otherwise known as the Tax Amnesty Act. There are two portions here of the law which I would like to remember, although we will discuss this later on when we talk about income taxation and also when we talk about the miscellaneous tax, the estate taxes, etc. The General Amnesty provides that all persons, whether natural or juridical, with internal revenue tax liabilities covering taxable year 2017 and 5 years, are allowed to avail of the tax amnesty within 1 year from the activity of Revenue Regulations number 4-2019. Unfortunately, the 1 year expired on April 24, 2020. The second component is the estate tax amnesty. This covers the estate of dissident or dissidents who died on or before December 31, 2017, whether or not there is a tax assessment that has been issued whose estate tax have remained unpaid as of December 31, 2017. This time, the law grants a longer period for the availment of the tax amnesty on estate taxes. It is within 2 years from the effectivity of Revenue Regulations number 6-2019 or until June 16, 2021. As I mentioned a while ago, the general tax amnesty shall be discussed in Module 3, Taxing Authority and Income Tax, while estate tax shall be discussed in Module 4, Estate Tax, Donors Tax, and others. How do you distinguish tax amnesty from tax exemption? Tax amnesty is an immunity from all criminal, civil, and administrative liabilities arising from the non-payment of taxes. Upon the other hand, tax exemption is an immunity from civil liability only. Furthermore, tax amnesty applies only to past periods. In short, it has retroactive effect, while tax exemptions has prospective application only applies in the future. So what questions have been asked in the past? What would be a typical bar question that could be asked from this area? It could be a simple one, either discuss a tax amnesty from tax exemption, or it may be define tax amnesty, define tax exemption, and others of similar character. So the distinctions are, if discuss that, just take note of it. The last area that's important for you, which is part of the coverage, but not so much that you should now break yourself trying to master this, would be the construction and interpretation of tax laws, rules, and regulations. There are only certain areas here that you must master, and you'll be warned as we go along in our discussion. But generally, there are few questions asked in this area. We have the general rule on construction interpretation, and the rule is that if the law is very clear in its provisions, then there's no need to interpret. So let's have a look at the slide now. It is a cardinal principle of statutory construction that where the provision of law is fixed categorically, the need for interpretation is obviated, no plausible pretense being entertained to justify non-compliance. All that has to be done is to apply it in every case that falls within its terms. And even if construction and interpretation of the law is insisted upon, following another fundamental rule that statutes are to be construed in the light of the purposes to be achieved and the evils sought to be remedied. So, we'll now talk about construction and interpretation of tax laws, tax exemption laws and exclusions, rules and regulations, penal provisions of tax laws, and then the non-retroactive application to taxpayers. We have the rules on the construction and interpretation of tax laws. And the general rule is that tax laws are construed in strictissimi juris against the government and liberally in favor of the taxpayer. What seems to be the reason behind this? The reason behind this is that taxes are burdens. And since they are burdens, they are not to be presumed. They must be clearly spelled out in order that the one who satisfies the burden, the taxpayer, would know exactly how he or she could comply with the burden. So remember, and don't get confused here. This is interpretation of tax laws, strictly against the government and liberally in favor of the taxpayer. I said, don't get confused. Because when you talk about the interpretation of tax exemption laws and exclusions, then the rule is in the reverse. What do I mean in the reverse? The rule is in the reverse because this time it is strictissimi juris against the taxpayer and liberally in favor of the government. But we'll talk about that later on. So long as of this now, at this moment, you know that there is a distinction between the two and you then get confused. Is there any exception to the strictissimi principle against the government insofar as tax laws are concerned? Yes, there is a solitary exception. And the solitary exception here is in the instance where there is a joint exercise of the power of taxation and police power. That's the solitary exception. So, is this dangerous for the bar? No, not really. Because the last time it was asked was way back in 1979, and after that, there were no more questions asked. So, whenever questions have been asked in the bar, it merely becomes a possibility and not a probability. It's just one of those that are nice to know, not imperative to know. So, we reiterate the statement. Just have a look at this. Especially the reason so you could expand your reasoning power. The reasons why there is strictissimi juris against the government and liberally in favor of taxpayers that taxes are burdens which must be endured by the taxpayer and therefore should not be presumed to go beyond what the law expressly and clearly declares. No person or property is subject to taxation unless they fall within the terms or plain import of a taxing statute. Since taxation is a destructive power which interferes with the personal and property rights of the taxpayer, it takes from them a portion of the property for the support of the government, tax statutes must be strictly construed against the government and liberally in favor of the taxpayer. So, what bar question could possibly be derived out of this? An objective type. What is the rule of statute reconstruction involving tax law? What is the reason therefore? Again, we hearken back to our 5% or less rule and more than 5% rule. So just have a look at this. Two sentences is enough for you. Supposing it's more than 5%, then you must expand. And look at how this was expanded. Citing cases, if you recall, but I said it's not imperative to cite cases. Just cite the doctrinal rulings here that have been set forth by the case. Is there an exception? Only one, but never the subject of a bar examination. Is a tax law that's promulgated jointly with the police power. What about tax exemptions and exclusions? So you have general rule, and as I said, this is more dangerous than the first one because this was asked already once in 2005. So what is the rule? Again, you have the general rule that tax exemptions and exclusions should be given a strictissimi juris interpretation against taxpayers and liberally in favor of the government. But by the way, before we proceed, let me recall to you, what is the meaning of exclusions? When you talk about exclusions, these are the items that are removed before the determination of gross income in order to arrive at the income subject to tax. So they're not included anymore in the computation of gross income. That's why they're excluded. And usually they're excluded by reasons of public policy or sometimes they are not income at all, that's why they are not included, they are excluded. That is the general rule. Is there any exception? Yes, there are lots of exceptions here, especially those involving the government, involving charitable institutions, NGO institutions, and other similar character that we shall discuss later on. So, let's go back. The general rule is that tax exemptions are to be construed in strictissimi juris against the taxpayer and liberally in favor of the state. But why is it so that there is such a strict interpretation against the taxpayer and liberal in favor of the state? Well, the first reason is the liberal doctrine upon which depends the state's existence. If there's going to be a liberal interpretation of tax exemptions, then there will be a lot of tax exemptions, and therefore the collection of taxes would suffer. There will be a diminution of tax revenues, and consequently, that might even lead to the demise of the state. Likewise, another reason behind it is that a state cannot strip itself of the most essential power of taxation. It cannot, by ambiguous language, be deprived of this highest attribute of sovereignty. Furthermore, here, there is need for a strictissimi interpretation to minimize differential treatment and foster impartiality, fairness, and equality of treatment among taxpayers. Now, we said the principle finds application to exclusions as well. Why? Because an exclusion is also an immunity or privilege which frees a taxpayer from a charge to which others are subjected to. So, what questions have been asked in the past? What are the type of questions asked in the past that might possibly be here the pattern to be used for future bar examinations? As usual, it is an objective type. Also, it could be a problem type. So, fact-based problem. So we go to the bottom. Decide. What are you supposed to decide? The exponential corporation maintains otherwise. You still don't understand, so go back one sentence. But the duties and taxes on these importations that these materials are not included in the exceptions because they are not utilized in the assembly of semiconductor devices. So after having seen the question at the bottom, you don't know that the issue is interpretation of tax exemptions. So let's go back to the problem and start determining whether or not there is basis now for us to apply the concept of strictissimi juris interpretation against the taxpayer and liberally in favor of the state. And how we're going to craft your answer, if the question weight is 5% or less, or if the question weight is more than 5%. So let's go back. Escolar Corporation was engaged in the assembly of semiconductor devices, and the corporation was considered as a pioneer enterprise under the provision of Shared Order Number 226. This is the Investment Incentive Law. These tax exemption certificates provide that all articles, goods, or materials used exclusively in the new and necessary industry are exempt from taxes. So there's an exception, and this is the way how the exemption is worded. You would notice the exemption is worded loosely. So therefore, in the interpretation of this exemption, you must use the strictissimi principle against the taxpayer and liberally in favor of the government. The corporation, during the height of the shortage of supply in the local market, imported cement and paper steel braces for use in the construction of the annex of its factory building, which is needed because of the increased demands of its products. The Bureau of Customs imposed duties and taxes on these importations on the ground that these materials are not included in the exemptions because they are not utilized in the assembly of semiconductor devices. The XYZ Corporation maintains otherwise decide. So you notice that the Bureau of Customs is applying the strictissimi principle against the taxpayer. And that's the proper way of interpreting tax exemptions, otherwise tax revenues will suffer. So having said that, let's now have a look at the two ways of answering, if it is a 5-point question or less, or if it's a more than 5 points. Let us look at an answer if the weight is 5% or less. The more 5% or less, the answer should be short and sweet. Just for example, this is only a 2-sentence answer. Why do I suggest that the answer should be short? For the reason that if it is a 5% question, then the time allocated for it is short compared with more than 5%. So notice, 2 sentences is already okay. Upon the other hand, if it is more than 5%, then you must expand your answer and include some embellishments. Why? Because your examiner is not only trying to test your knowledge of the subject, but also trying to test how you could defend yourself through the answers, testing your skills in written English. So let's see how this was expanded. We have another question here, which is a theoretical discussion question. So just the same again, we look at the five and more than five answers. So we have here 5% or less. Supposing it's more than 5%, it's going to be longer. What about exceptions to the strict limit rule on construction and interpretation of tax exemptions and exclusions? Again, this is probable because it was given once in 2005. And I believe this is a rather dangerous area, so watch out for it. By the way, questions asked here are nothing more than enumeration questions. So these are the exceptions to the strict limit juris in the interpretation of tax exemptions. In short, it's now going to be liberal construction in favor of the taxpayer and strictly against the government. Why? The reasons behind this are public policy considerations, sometimes also based on fairness and justice. So let's look at the enumerations now, or the instances when, even if it is tax exemption, it's going to be strictly construed against the government and liberally in favor of the taxpayer. So, first, when the statute itself provides for liberal interpretation or construction. Number two, in case of special taxes relating to special cases and affecting only special classes of persons or people. If exemptions refer to public property, why so? Because the general rule is that, insofar as taxation is concerned for the government, exception is the rule and taxation is the exception. Likewise, exceptions granted to charitable and educated institutions of the properties should be liberally construed. What is the reason behind granting exemptions to charitable institutions and educated institutions? We talked about that before. The reason is that if the state does not grant incentives to them in the form of liberal interpretation of their exemptions, then the state would have to set up charitable institutions, the state would have to set up public schools and other similar character, therefore burdening the state with more expenditures. Likewise also, exemptions in favor of a government political subdivision or instrumentality would have to be liberally construed. Because again, we said, remember, the rule in taxation, insofar as government is concerned, exception is the rule and taxation is the exception. Let's look at more questions here that have been asked in the past related to this particular area. And we said, basically, objective. The rule that tax exemptions are to be strictly construed as certain exceptions, what are they? Go back to the 5 and 10% rule. Then you have construction of tax rules and regulations. No questions were asked in the bar from 64 to 2019. Now, remember, tax rules and regulations are in the nature of tax statutes. But, while that may be so, the rule is now reversed in the sense that, as a general rule, the Internal Revenue Code, the tax code has provided that with respect to tax rulings and regulations, they should not have here a retroactive effect if it will be adverse to the taxpayer. So the rule is reversed. Tax laws is strictly against the government, but this time, when you talk about this, it is strictly against the taxpayer and liberally in favor of the government. So, but having said that, I would like you to remember that there are certain instances when there are exceptions. In short, it is reversed. It's strictly against the taxpayer and liberally in favor of the government. Let's go back before I get confused. The rule for interpretation of tax laws is extremis juris against the government and liberally in favor of the taxpayer. That's the general rule with respect to interpretation of tax laws. However, while tax rules and regulations, tax rulings and regulations, are the force and effect of laws, the interpretation is different. It's going to be liberally in favor of the taxpayer and strictly against the state, such that if the ruling is prejudicial to the interest of the taxpayer, then there should be no retroactive application at all. Remember that, So, and then don't get confused. So, let's solidify your understanding of this, although I doubt it if your question is going to be asked here, because there were no questions asked in the past regarding this area. That's why exams probably think this area is innocuous. It's not that important. So, in general, rules and regulations issued by administrative or executive officers pursuant to the procedure or authority conferred by law upon the administrative agency have the force and effect or partake of the nature of a statute. True. But when you talk about interpretation, the rule now is different from the interpretation of a tax statute as I discussed a while ago. So, how do you now interpret the penal provisions of tax law? This was the subject of a bar examination asked in the past. Only once, never repeated, but then take note of it. It's close. It's a little bit, almost 10 years. That's why whenever questions have been asked within the period of 20 years, decade of the 20s, then I believe that they're probable for the bar exams. So watch out for this. And therefore, let's look at the interpretation of penal provisions of tax laws. The penal provisions of tax laws receive a strict construction in favor of the government. In the case there are any limitations, this shall only be allowed in the instance where there is such a strict interpretation in order to show that they are really intended to be limitations. Limitations are never to be presumed in this particular regard. So to repeat, penal provisions of tax laws receive a strict construction in favor of the government, and the limitations in such cases will not be presumed in the absence of clear legislation. So let's have a look at a bar question that was asked in the past, typical bar question, and let us see. In criminal cases involving tax offenses punishable under the NRC, prescription is construed strictly against the government. So, you must now explain this concept. We hearken back to the 5 and 10% rule. Now, one that there is a probability of being repeated would be the concept that favorable via rulings may be reversed. They are not permanent in character. And the taxpayer could not claim that he or she has a vested right insofar as the ruling is concerned. Why? Because these rulings again could be reversed for the reason that if it is erroneous, the government is not bound by the errors of its agents. And of course, you go back to the hoary and most repeated lifeblood doctrine. So let's have a look at the concept here and see how we could resolve this particular area. A peer ruling favorable to a taxpayer would not necessarily create a perpetual exemption in his favor. So remember that there's going to be your reasoning process, but that is merely a conclusion. So you must now come up with the reasoning process why in fact it does not create a perpetual exemption. The reason is that the government is not stopped from collecting taxes because of mistakes or errors on the part of its agents. So remember, the government is never stopped by the errors of its agents. The Commissioner of Internal Revenue is not bound by the ruling of its predecessors. Because they were the same. Why? Because the overruling of decisions is inherent in the interpretation of laws. Erroneous application and enforcement of the law by public officers do not preclude subsequent correct application of the statute. And the government is never stopped by mistakes or errors on the part of its agents. And which reminds me, this is an aside, no? Remember, ABS-CBN is claiming that there have been certain instances when the NTC granted provisional authorities even if there was an expiration of the franchise. Remember, the NTC is not bound by that because it is a mistake to do so, and consequently, the government is never bound by the errors of its agents. Aside lang yun, ha? So let's look at the bar type questions that have been asked in the past relative to this particular area. You have a fact-centered question, so we go to the bottom of the problem. Could the BR now assess debt printers for back taxes corresponding to the years before the ruling? So when you look at this, you would notice that there was previously a favorable ruling, but now the Bureau of Internal Revenue changed that ruling. So to confirm our analysis, let's go back now and have a look at the question from the very beginning. And as we read the questions, we'll have to intelligently try to determine exactly what is the nature of the problem. Due to the uncertainty whether or not a new tax law is applicable to printing companies, the printer submitted a legal query to the Bureau of Internal Revenue on that issue. The Bureau of Internal Revenue issued a ruling that printing companies are not covered by the new law. Relying on this ruling, the printers did not pay said tax. Subsequently, however, the BR reversed the ruling and issued a new one stating that the tax covers printing companies. Could the BR now assess the printers for back taxes corresponding to the years before the new ruling? Reason briefly. There are two suggested answers here, both of which conflict with each other. Therefore, I would suggest that you try to evolve one that you're comfortable with. Both of them are correct, but you do not know what is the view of the examiner. Therefore, in this particular regard, I would suggest that you discuss both, but you must choose one. So let's look at the first answer. The first answer is no. The reversal will prejudice the taxpayer who acted in good faith upon the previous BIR ruling. Taxpayers should not be prejudiced by an erroneous interpretation by the taxpayer, particularly on a difficult question of law. Absent fraud, bad faith, or misrepresentation, the reversal of a specific ruling should apply prospectively and not retroactively. Now, let's look at the contra, which is entirely opposite to this first one that you've seen. Yes. Kanina no, ngayon yes. The general rule is that the state cannot be put in stopper by the mistakes or errors of its agent. The above doctrine finds application especially in the case of taxation, where the revenues collected is the lifeblood upon which the government depends for its existence, continued existence. However, debt should not be subject to the payment of interest, fines, surcharges, and other penalties for the late payment of the deficiency taxes. Because after all, it should not be penalized for its reliance in good faith upon the previous interpretation. We have another one which is basically an objective type, and we would have to apply here the 5 and 10% rule. The CBR ruling have a retroactive effect considering the principle that tax exemptions should be interpreted strictly against the taxpayers. So 5% or less? No. Any revocation, modification, or ruling of their ruling shall not be given retroactive effect if the revocation, modification, or reversal will be prejudicial to the taxpayer. More than 5%? No. But you must not explain this further. That's why your answer is expanded. However, their rulings would have retroactive effect even if prejudicial to the interest of the taxpayer, and then you have the instances when that happens. This is an exact provision, by the way, a provision of the NRC, which is section 246. That ends our discussion on Module 1, General Principles. So, hooray, we have finished Module 1, General Principles. And let's party. After the party, you could now proceed to the other modules designed for taxation law review. Thank you very much, and hope you look for the other modules so that you better understand taxation. Thank you very much.